Yeah.
Yeah, the parking was great.
Okay.
Easy to find parking.
Okay, Sean. This is where we're gonna get most of our stuff with your guys. Right. We're rolling. Okay. And right. So Kelly, you take a seat because I'm gonna actually have you two guys meet Rena.
Please sit next to me. Hey, Rena. Nice to meet you.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, here we go. I want to start with who, what, why, where, and how of your existence, not only here, but what you can do to tell us how you have mentored or how you have wanted to mentor students, young people, even old people.
Yes.
New changing industry that we're in. Okay. So really, these are just sound bites that we're going to try to get from you guys.
Sure. Okay. Someone's asking questions.
I'm just going to be having conversations with you. Shelly.
Yeah, you got to be.
Very cool. So you're from your family or you're from New Mexico, you were mentioning?
No, I'm actually from New York.
New York.
My family
okay.
in New Mexico. Cool.
Okay, we're going to start again. Tell us who you are.
Okay, great.
A little bit about yourself.
Yeah, you start.
Okay, great. Okay. Hello, everybody. Hi, everybody. My name is Rena Tolentino. I'm an artist, curator, and brand relationship manager here in Los Angeles, and we're here at the Microsoft office. Welcome. Okay, so here I have Shelly, and she's from the Artists Art Directors Guild. Okay, Shelly. So please introduce yourself and tell us where you're from.
Okay.
And what your job title is, and as well as your involvement with the community and mentoring kids from adults to youth.
I am from New York originally. I studied architecture, moved to California, and ended up in the entertainment industry as an art director, set designer, and I'm going on 30 years in the industry. So I've done a lot of medium from, you know, TV, variety shows, sitcoms, features, and single camera episodic television. I give back a lot because I was fortunate enough to have a mentor. I started off early in my career after I left architecture with a gentleman by the name of William Newman, who is now retired and living in Bellingham. But Bill was one of those mentors that taught me a lot about being open to everything, being sure that I didn't just focus on my career and the skills I needed, because I very arrogantly thought I had them all, you know, and I found out that it was important to give back, and then in giving back, you gain so much more to the pie that, you know, it's not just the skills and the drive, but it's the community. And now I'm a member of a board member of the Kids in the Spotlight, which is an organization that mentors foster youth, helping them tell their stories through film. It's one of the things I do, but I've been on a lot of panels like Design Minds and other symposiums like Mosaic from my college, and recently the Pan African Film Festival. So it's important that I do a lot of giving back, a lot of reaching out, because our community has a long way to go. We have a lot to do in terms of getting equity and inclusion in this industry still behind the camera.
Wow, that's, you are so busy.
We have no choice. We really don't have a choice. We have to keep fighting to ensure our voices, our stories are told, and we can't do them if we're not behind the camera as well as in front of the camera. So we're making stress.
So what projects are you working on right now with your community that we need to know about? And how can we get involved with the projects that you're doing?
Wow, that's great. My bread and butter, of course, is doing regular television shows like Black Mafia, Family, and SEAL Team. But with kids, we are actually building stages. We just acquired a studio in Van Nuys.
Well, that's huge.
Yeah, it's huge. It's 13 years now this organization has existed, and we have a fundraiser every year. And we always need writers, directors, hands on deck to help put these stories together for the students. And we do this every year. So studio's open now. I'm there several days a week, and we are, Taiji Cherry is the founder and a friend of mine. And so we love to have people come and lender talents. And that's what we need right now, is a lot more of that happening so we can get these stories told. And my goal is, my wish is that we would actually make a film from one of these student stories into a feature film.
Well, let's do it. Did you hear that? There's a lot of kids that could participate in this. You heard that. So how can they apply for the program or to work with you?
I would love to be that streamlined to kids, but okay. You know, other than me directly reaching out to kids and kids.org or kidsinthespotlight.org is a nonprofit that we would welcome all talent, whether you're from a foster background or not. We just welcome hands on deck and help. And then of course the Art Directors Guild, I'm working along with my fellow members with the diversity, equity, and inclusion to educate, create pathways for people who may not have, you know, hands on experience, but we're trying to make a way for them to bring more BIPOC people in, because the guild is in need of a lot more, you know, inclusion right now.
That's very true. Can you walk us over, because not many people know how to talk to mentors or not sure where to go about getting a mentor. Mm-hmm. Can you walk us through your experience and how you were able to get a mentor?
I was one of those young people who went to all things like this. I would go to these events. I would walk up to the people afterwards. I'd get their information. I'd share mine, however they were most comfortable, but I'd follow through. So key is, you know, not to be a nag, but you have to continually reach out. How's it going? What's going on? What's new? And then that person, if they're sincere, they will find opportunities to bring you in and have opportunities for you to show your work. And you just have to maintain that relationship. And I think that's the key. I think mentors are everywhere. There's so many people who want to help, but I think it's incumbent upon the young and this generation to ensure that they maintain that relationship, because that is the hardest part.
How would you, because I am having trouble with following up with people. I am not the best. I go through my artist stages where I just don't even want to talk to people. So how can we overcome that hump with like, oh, it's been 3 weeks, I haven't followed up with that person. Like, do you just, like, how do you get over that?
It's a lot simpler than you think.
How do you get over that ego?
Yeah, you have to get out of yourself and think of them as like your cousin or your auntie, and you just, you know, shoot them a text. Hey, how you doing today? Or want to go to lunch? Or, you know, send them a funny card. Or, hey, I just saw something, I thought of you. You know, you just have to, it's like a lifeline. You know, you just constantly have to throw something out. They know that you are alive and that you still care. And it goes a long way when you're mentoring. I can speak to being a mentee, and now I can speak to being a mentor. I think the key is knowing that you care enough, because our time gets busy and it's hard to sort of keep reaching out to the person that wants to learn. The person wanting to teach needs to know you care enough so that they can continue to pull you in when the time is right. Because it's all about timing. And if you don't run the race, like stay engaged, and that opportunity can come and go, and you just have to remember that. You just have to, you know, keep the line open any way you can. Let's go to lunch, let's do this, happy birthday, you know, anything you can do, because most likely they'll probably pay for lunch, but you know, at least offer.
You heard it from Shelley.
You know, they know your work, you're not there yet, but it's the key. It means a lot, especially coming from that generation that I was raised writing thank you notes. And I know that's a foreign concept, but you must stay engaged with your mentor. That could make or break you, because there's so much more to learn than the job. There's so much more about the politics, and it's a life lesson no matter what field you're in. So please maintain that line of communication.
Amen, sis. Honestly, I need to hear that.
So don't close yourself off, Rita.
Okay. Are these opportunities paid? Do you have any paid opportunities for these students?
That's for me directly at this moment in time. I don't have a paid internship, but most internships lead to paying jobs, and that's one of the things we're working on at the Guild, Art Directors Guild, is creating those paid opportunities. There are few and far between right now, but somehow we've all kind of come together after the summer of protest 2020, and a lot of paying organizations are working with those of us gathering the students and gathering the prospective designers so that we can get them paid. So
okay.
It's hard to explain, but you know, I personally don't have them, but I know that they exist and that we're trying to make sure we combine the, those wanting it with the opportunities at the gift.
Okay, great. So let's say,
once it starts happening, how much can mentees basically expect to make under your program?
Wow, that's sky's the limit.
Okay, so let's say once a mentees get in your program and there are paid programs, how does that look like in terms of like how much would they eventually get paid? And yeah.
Well, that's the broad spectrum, but let me say this.
Yes, very broad.
Let's just say that the entertainment industry can provide a very good lifestyle. Okay. I was as impressed with the music industry. I mean, the sky is the limit. You know, there's a lot of money to be made, and there are different positions, and it's not, I can't just say a number, but right. I can honestly say you would be able to pay off those student loans, okay? And you would, you know, definitely find that it's a good way of life, because it's not just about the money, but it's about, you know, yes, you want to pay your bills, but yeah, you also want to have a lifestyle that works.
Mm-hmm.
And it's important to balance, right? But this is a, for me, it became an industry that I felt was a good lifestyle, because I was an architect first. So I, you know, you have to find your muse, but I do feel like it is an industry, a good career industry, and there's so much opportunity, so many different layers, mm-hmm. right? I say I'm a set designer, art director, Lemo is production director, Dionisio is a scenic artist. So, I mean, there's a lot to do in the arts that actually pays and creates a lifestyle, a living, you know, lifestyle, a good lifestyle.
Well, thank you for that. Yes, I hope this gets everybody pumped to apply. Can you please mention the nonprofit again?
Yes.
So apply.
It's kidsinthespotlight.org and also the artdirectorsguild.org. Two organizations where there are work opportunities in the arts.
Yes, and this is Shelly. Please don't forget to reach out to her, Shelly Wallace.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, thank you, Shelly.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you very much. Yes. Is there any other more questions you'd like to?
Yes. How does it allow me to be? Oh, very good question. Oh my goodness. Woo, that, yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Okay, so being in the entertainment industry, how does it allow people to build their character or to cultivate their character or to nourish their character?
Mm.
Yeah.
It's an exceptionally good question, because as a person of color, you're challenged by, everyone knows the term gatekeeping.
Yes.
You know, there's a lot of that. There's a lot of naysayers. And, you know, as an artist, you're super sensitive as it is. But I think, you know, you have to learn, you grow in patience and you grow in communication, because you can only handle these situations a certain way to maintain yourself. And you do find you have to dig deep, and you do end up building a very strong backbone.
Yes.
And then you find allies. And then when you find allies and you share your stories, then you start to feel heard. So it's a real challenge, because you are a sensitive creative, but you're also this human being trying to create a pathway for you and the people behind you. And it's right. Not an easy thing. I'm not going to lie. It's not an easy path, but it's worth it, because you do build character and you get to where I'm at now, where I'm like, yeah, I'm about that now. I'm about, let's give it back. I've done it now. I've got a lot of experience. I know my worth. And you tend to find the courage to, you know, build another day, I guess, you know, each day, each day, you know, you kind of like each time you successfully navigate a show and all the personalities, it just prepares you for the next and the next. So you do, your character does get challenged, and you do sharpen that, those skills and your integrity.
Right. Thank you. I love that. How, I want to know, has there been any moments where you had to deal with a bunch of haters when you were like trying to, you know, or just enemies? You're like, how do you know, that dynamic in those interpersonal relationships and those teamwork environments, how do you not, you know, how do you,
oh, I know, yeah,
how do you build your character and still have to deal with the haters? Like, I'm just want to, you know,
I think that's where the mentors come in.
Right.
I think those people you can trust and talk to about those daily challenges. I think that's a huge thing for our people to overcome, because we're always, they're always at you and you're just trying to get your job. So, you know, there are days where you're just like, I'm done. But, you know, that's when you take that moment, you step aside, you get with the mentor. But ultimately, you start to become, you know, a lot more gracious and patient. And you temper that. And you take that anger and make yourself better. That's what you do.
Ooh, wonderful. Okay. Hi, Jeff. Hello. How are you? Thanks for being here. Thank you, Shelley. Well, we're here at the Microsoft office, and I'm here with Jeff Burke. So, Jeff, tell me about yourself, what you do, what projects you're working on, and your role as a mentor, and what you want to see or what you need more.
Sure. Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you for having me. So I teach at UCLA in the School of Theater, Film, and Television. I'm the Associate Dean for Research and Technology there, and I teach in the theater department. My interest is really in how technology is impacting production. And so both live experience and sort of the future of the film production. I was trained as an engineer. And so I'm particularly sort of interested in working with students that are maybe in the sciences, but have an interest in the arts and want to figure out how to cross over, or students who are in the arts and want to figure out.
So STEAM.
Like how to, so STEAM.
That's what exactly. I'm about.
Okay, so
I'm an artist. Tell me always more, so
what are your questions about? No. What do you do? What are you doing? Like, how
So I do a lot. It's not about me right now. I do a lot of analog astronaut simulation. So it's all about STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So I'm the artist, and I'm always plugging in art in STEM environments, because we see a lot of, you know, technology and engineering, but no one ever thinks about art as a way for therapy, right? So that's what I do with these astronauts. I put art and therapy in, so I want to infuse tech and art. And so yeah, so you're here, so it's great to I just want to hear more about how you're putting this all together, because there's so many trailblazers doing similar things. So I just want to hear what each person, I just want to hear what.
Sure. So like my interest, right, I've done a bunch of different types of art, from, you know, really experimental stuff to pretty traditional live performance. And my interest right now is looking at augmented reality in live performance. So what happens when we're able to have a concert or a theatrical experience or some other kind of live event, and really integrated in a fundamental way with what we might have on a mobile device, what might happen on a screen or on a headset. And since I'm at a university, I have sort of a lucky opportunity to really dig into what are the storytelling challenges, what are the production design challenges. We had some folks that are talking about production design. And so like our students that are working in this area are thinking about, how do I design a physical set and a digital set, not just to like be put together in cinema, like not to be put together in the frame at the end, but to be experienced by a live audience. And so those are like two really cool technical challenges, really cool artistic challenges. So that's like the current work that I'm doing. And then mentorship wise, I'm really interested in how people can see technology as something they can shape for their own purposes and their own stories. And it's not something that they have to receive that somebody else is making. And so it comes from, you know, in engineering, sort of believing that you can engineer something that's specific to you or specific to your story, and you don't have to just accept the things that are coming at you as products. And so that's what kind of, like, I love those types of mentorship opportunities, and I'm trying to think I'm here because we're trying to build more opportunities for that type of thing at UCLA, and then putting together some proposals to try to really enhance the support for STEAM experimentation in the LA area.
Wow, that's great. So what projects are you working on right now that kids can apply to?
So I think we have a lot of different things. It's kind of like Shelley said, like what the best thing that I've found, since we don't have like a boilerplate program in what I do, we have a center, we do projects, is for people to reach out that have an interest in production that brings together these different parts of their life or ways of working. Usually it's folks that are students either at UCLA or nearby, but I'm always just interested to talk to people. So I think in particular, like the types of things that we're doing right now are really close to like real-time game engines. So like if you're working in Unreal or Unity, or you're thinking about like what are new ways to create there, and you're interested in like everyday life and like IRL, the IRL world,
yeah,
and you want to create there too, what I would just like in real life. Do I have to plan for this slides? But I would say they should just like reach out. Our center is called UCLA Remap, and we don't have like a lot of things where we can take big groups of students. We're trying to build that, but I love to talk to people and see if we can find individual ways for them to work with us.
Okay, cool. Are there any paid opportunities?
Sometimes. It's open right now, but sometimes, and that is one way that we can also get people that are coming kind of from outside UCLA involved, or inside UCLA, is that if we have paid work and work study positions and things like that, we try to find ways to hire people. So nothing like right off the top of my head now, but if people email, I try to keep the resumes, connect them to stuff that's going on, and hopefully we'll have more of a pipeline.
Is there any, like, how do people stand out? Because I'm sure there's going to be so many kids, like there's so much competition. Like, what to you would stand out on their resume?
It's a question that a lot of people ask about, like applying to UCLA in general. And I'm usually looking for people that have like a combination of a clear creative vision or like way of presenting how they see the world, like their own creativity comes through, and that have followed through, like have evidence of like following through, whether it's consistent job or a really well done application or portfolio,
well done application? What does that look like?
I mean, something where they have spent time to convey what's unique about them. They have,
so you want
to
see their style,
something that where style comes through, and that they do it consistently and well. And I don't know, does that help?
No, it does. I think we
see lots of people who are very smart and very like have done great things, but like you want to know about them as an individual and what they're going to bring to a creative project, and then they will stick all the way through. They will see it through.
Right. Okay. Question. Oh, wait, what's your question?
You want to go ahead first?
No, I want to know yours. Okay, talking about STEAM and digital media, but are there any projects that are diving into AR or the metaverse? Okay, great. So we're talking about STEAM and digital art and the metaverse. Do you have any specific projects that are tailoring for that?
Yeah, so we have a project that's in development right now that's an AR theater piece. That is, you know, pretty much a full scale production we're trying to develop. We have technology projects. If there are folks that have a computer science or engineering interest or background that are really about like what's the future of a decentralized and open approach to the metaverse, those types of things. Those are the types of research and production projects that we do. And so like to talk to people about them and kind of share what's going on, find ways to connect them maybe to others. Even if we don't have something for them to do, like connect them to somebody else that might be a place where they could do that. So,
very awesome. Do you have any more questions?
You were typing it out.
Why don't you just, I would just say it. I'll just
like, any advice for any prospectors trying to get into either UCLA or other colleges, film and programs, and what else they can do to stand out other than like the creative writing, your essays, anything?
I can give you a meta answer.
So do you have a meta answer on how people can stand out when they're applying for?
I think if you can, like, find a faculty member or an alum at the place that you're interested in going and talk to them, because each university has its own care, especially like if you're looking at a film program or another create like a digital media program, like go find out the character of the program, what they're looking for in applications and what they'll give to you, and kind of know that when you go, because it really is quite different, right? If you're applying to a university that's focused on really traditional kind of approaches, which may be great for some students, but you apply in a certain way with a certain type of portfolio, or if it's a new kind of multidisciplinary program, you may want to apply in a different way and emphasize different parts of your skills. So I think I would suggest, like, find somebody who will talk to you from that university. And most people, I think they will. Like, I always try to respond if somebody writes, like, just a little email, like you should. And you should try to help them understand. And so I think most people do, like, just to take that extra step, learn about the programs that you're interested in, and reach out. That would, I think, be the best thing.
Wow, thank you. It's good to know you check your emails.
And write again. If you don't get a response, it's not personal. Like, write again and get people to respond.
Oh, thank you so much, Jeff. Is there anything else you want to mention, or?
We covered it.
Okay. Thank you. Nice to meet you, Jeff.
But I definitely would love to continue a conversation with you, because I'm, as we speak outside of here, I'm breaking down a script, and it's real life. And
if I'm not here, I'll give you a card, and then if I'm not here, I'll be around a little bit. But that would be fun. We've been thinking about that kind of stuff a lot. The cards are here. Cards are kind of bent and wrinkled.
Oh, here, let me just take a photo, because I know you have a lot.
I've got things, but
I'm the only one in LA that will reach out to you.
All right, sounds good.
Thank you, Jeff.
Yeah, thank you. Absolutely. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
What's your name?
I'm Lamo.
Lamo, yeah. Rina. Nice to meet you, Lamo.
Now the heat is on.
Okay, great. Oh,
it's the last day of my maybe the day that slavery was over. Or maybe
I think Black History Month is every month. That's just the way that I don't want to designate it to one month. Just like how they put Filipino, whatever, Asian American month. Right. I'm like, it's every day. Black History
Month. Yeah, I live it. I was going to remind that the shirt is controversial, if you will. It's like, I make Black History. And I'm like, what do you do? And I'm like, oh, well, I mean,
you are. He is walking Black History. Okay, so please introduce yourself and.
You guys start over, whatever you think.
Oh, we were just getting to know
each other. Oh,
yeah, that was just. Okay. Yeah.
Don't mind me.
So.
Okay, so hey, welcome, Lamo. Thank you for being here at the Microsoft
office. Thank you for having me. It's a cool space. Like, who wouldn't want to be there?
Yes, it is. It's so great. I can do cartwheels and everything. There's a lot of space here.
Tons of space.
So please tell us about what your company does, why you're here, what projects you're working on, what changes you want to see in the job that you're doing now, because we, you know, previous to this, we're talking a lot about change. So yeah, just share it with you.
So I'm Lamo. I'm a production designer and also practice architecture. So I started my career in architecture. Did that for a number of years. 20. Who's counting? Plus. And then, yeah, I know, I'm like 20. And I segued into film. So there in the film world, I still practice architecture in a sense with film, but I'm a production designer. So I'm involved with the overall look, the environments in which the characters live. So that's what I do. And also I work closely with a nonprofit organization called SMP Rise. And what we do there is, you can find it at smprise.org. You can find it on the web. And what we do is basically mentor, and we collect mentees, and we teach them things that they need to know that you just won't find on the film set. People have a tendency when it comes to mentors or just people in positions, they fail to realize that they had a start. And so that's one thing that we're really big paying it forward and giving our knowledge to someone younger.
Is there an age range?
No, you just have to have dedication. Because I just finished a short.
So you can be like 19 years old.
Yes.
And apply.
Yes, 19. Of course, you can apply. Yeah.
So I can still apply. I'm a little over the 19.
You're 18, so I don't know. We may have to like revisit it, but. A recent project, my mentee was 55 plus, but he had a passion to work in the art department. So I'm like, come on over, and he learned a lot. And I was there, you know, it's not an ego thing, it's not an ageism thing, it's, we're here to create a great project. So that's
love that. Moment. Did you hear that? No ageism.
Yeah, none.
Any age, that's just, yes. I love that, because I find a lot of entertainment, it's always like, you have to be from this age to this age, and if you don't, then, you know, you're cut. And it's like, a lot of the times I was like, well, you look younger, but I don't fit that age group. And so I was automatically cut. And so it's good to know that there's avenues, that there's no age discrimination. So yeah, this is really great that you have this opportunity for just essentially anyone and everyone who has the willingness to learn.
And the desire.
And the desire.
The desire. This film is not easy, but you have to have some level of dedication and discipline to show up on set every day. Do a banging job.
Wow, amazing. So what projects are you working on now? What do you need help with? Who do you know? What do you need? Do you need mentors? Look, do you need mentee?
I'm all about paying it forward. So I love to just like give back, because I wouldn't have made it to architecture, which then led into film, if someone didn't pour into me. So I pay it forward. So I'm currently in between like two scripts that I'm breaking down. They're gonna start later on in this year, but I have to get myself into those worlds. Mm-hmm. You know, like I find myself living the life of the character for a moment. Like, no, you know, I like to just like inject myself into the script and create a wonderful environment, whether it's, you know, a thriller or something that's more serious and a true to life story. So, and my background is feature and episodic. So those two are like very different, but
right.
You know.
So what's the process like for someone to apply for your program? Or how long is the program? And are there any paid opportunities within that program? Or what's the exposure like?
The paid is having a great project at the end. So with SMP Rise, what we do is, you know, we'll pair ourselves with, you know, we'll partner with a young developer, like, you know, someone that wrote the script, whether, you know, whatever their role is. So we'll take their story and we'll try to shoot their project within a week. So at the end, you will have something that you'll be proud of. You can take and say, hey, you know, I've actually worked on a set with someone, a skilled professional. So it's not like, you know, the blind leading the blind. This is like, no, it's a real production. It's something that you can be happy with at the end of the day. So you just go online, smprise.org, and you, I think it's called, you know, somewhere up in the, I think it's the second thing that you would click on, look for mentees. And we're also accepting mentors. So if you want to mentor someone with your skill, you know, we'll put it in our database. So when we do get a project like Jeff, you know, dealing with the metaverse,
right,
we can, hey, you know, Jeff, are you available? Come on in. That's what we like to do. We just like to keep a little ecosystem, community.
Are you open to working with other nonprofit or organizations? Okay.
Yes. So recently how I landed here is I moderated a panel at the Pan African Film Festival. It was the 31st year, and I saw a need, because everyone knows hair, makeup, actors and actresses, but they don't know the other key elements that go into making a great film. So thankfully, the Pan African Film Festival, they listened and they allowed me to inject costume design. Who else did that? Some athletes that are, you know, no longer professional athletes, and now they're acting. So like, I was able to contribute that, and also a panel with I moderated a panel with fellow colleagues from the Art Directors Guild. I also sit as a co-chair with the diversity and inclusion over at ABG. So it was very important for me discovering that I'm like one of 10 out of 3,500 plus. That's a problem. So my efforts are to educate and inform others that, you know, hey, production design,
right,
art direction, it's actually a thing. And you too can be a member.
Right.
You know, it's just like we don't know that it exists most of the time because we all hair, makeup, costume. That's all we know. So
how would a mentee stand out to you? Like if you had to choose a mentee, like what would be the factor that would help you decide, okay, this person is like, is it like, would they show that they're a team player, or is it like the first impression, or is it their resume, or like what would stand out as, you know, to you?
I think it's a summation of all those things. Okay. But for me, I'm artistic. Okay. So having a very well-crafted portfolio is what will do the job for me. And following up with dedication and showing that you can deliver, that's something that stands out for me.
Timeliness.
Yes, timeliness. Knowing your craft and willing to take criticism and improving your craft. That's a major thing. You know, it's okay to have individuality, but at the same rate, you want to be open and willing to listen and learn. That's a major element that some people today just don't
have common sense.
Yeah. That, of course. It's like, we don't need common sense. Like, yeah.
Well, thank you.
No problem. Thank you for having us.
Sure. Yes. Hug. Yes. We'll give each other a hug.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great day roaming around Microsoft Office.
I will.
I see you bouncing back and forth, and then you're wearing yellow, and I'm like, she's a tennis ball.
I'm a tennis ball?
I feel so bad. It's like, coming right.
You
need to take a breather. Okay.
Same.
I know you've been here for a minute, right? You've been talking. Okay. Yeah. Hi, I'm Dionisio. Nice to meet you.
We met briefly over there. Okay.
What was your name again?
Rena.
Rena.
Yes.
Okay.
What a cool name.
Yes. And what do you do?
I'm an artist. My name is Rena. I'm an artist, curator, brand relationship manager.
Oh, okay. Great. I might need a little bit of that.
Oh, I'm going to help you with a little bit of everything.
Wonderful.
Not just a little bit of that, but a little bit of everything.
I was kind of curious, what's the yellow caution thing? Is that
this right here?
No, the little yellow thing.
Oh, this Optimized. Is like, it's just okay.
Okay.
I wonder why Anna Marie's trying to get in here. I guess we can let her in.
Okay. Whatever. I don't know what this is.
So this isn't even part of this.
No,
I mean, this is, here. But it's just a Zoom thing.
Is this what?
I'm like, all y'all can see my nostrils. Like, you really want to see that?
That's the biggest concern I have.
Oh, but here's what we can do if that's making you guys.
Even when I'm all by myself.
Look at that. No more counsel.
Just wow. Okay, great. I like staring at myself.
Are you from the LA area? I'm here.
Born and raised on top of the. Yeah, and then I grew up in the valley. I went to school.
Which valley? San Gabriel?
San Fernando.
Okay. When I say Candace here next, then we.
Hello. Hi. Good to see you. Hello. Hi.
Okay, so. What we're going to do is we're going to continue here, and then we're going to go there, and then we're going to keep rotating as much as the same. Or no, after I'm going to put Ted in.
Like a tennis ball with a large personality.
Thank you. Hey, what's up? I'm Rena Tolentino. I'm an artist, curator, brand relationship manager, and we're here at Microsoft Office, and I have two amazing people here with me, but I can't tell you who they are yet, because first we're going to interview this person.
She can't tell you who we are because my name's very hard to pronounce.
Yeah, it is. Actually, I wanted to ask you to announce your name again.
Yes.
And I'd also like to know if you know the meaning of your name, because it's very unique. So I want to share that with us.
Okay. I'll try to be brief about it.
Okay.
Because I actually have like 20 books on the shelf all about my name. Because I was curious.
Know your name, know where you come from, know your roots. And the part of it is knowing your name. And so that's what I wanted to ask.
So my name is Dionisio Tafoya, and that's a derivative of the Greek god Dionysus, which For some people, you know, they're like, what is that? I mean, so that was the Greek god of theater, wine, and chaos, apparently. And that's kind of like me. Kind of a little bit out there. But I am with the Art Directors Guild, and I am their chair of professional development. I am on their board of directors. I'm a trustee. I am also a board member of an organization called Creating Creators Incorporated, which does educational outreach programs for students looking to get career pathways into the entertainment industry, everything from music to film and the traditional arts.
Arts, yeah.
Yes. So
very cool.
Yes.
So what projects are you working on right now?
I am working on a lot of projects.
What are you most excited about?
I am excited about everything. I try to be excited about anything that I'm getting involved in. I'm excited about this today because it's allowed me to meet a lot of different people in the education/entertainment nexus.
Yeah.
Right? And so one of the things that I'm most excited about is the program that I am working with at Creating Creators. So it's a digital immersive scanning and modeling, and we're teaching high school students how to scan and model digital spaces so that way they can have career pathways to our Art Directors Guild. I personally started out as a scenic painter, so murals.
Oh, I got to get you on a mural project that I'm doing. Can I get you?
See, that's going to be the next exciting project that I work on.
Because I do mural projects too. Yeah, so we can collaborate on that. I can have you paint something.
Okay. Are we sharing? Because the way they were doing it before was it was one camera over here, then they would move a camera. So are we two? Are we three shot? Okay.
So, we can have fun.
Oh, so what am I doing? Hi, hello. My name is Candace Newman. I am the CEO and founder of Live Out Live. I'm LA-based, senior level executive and producer in the live concert touring industry. Live Out Live is an organization that's inspired by my career and journey as a Black woman in the live concert industry. I worked in corporate America for 10 plus years in the live concert business. But experienced a lot of hurdles and setbacks and marginalization within corporate America. So I carved out a new pathway through Live Out Live where I wanted to create access, opportunity, provide resources, give access to my network to marginalized, disenfranchised groups, specifically Black and Latin, young adults and professionals, and women.
Women who run this.
But furthermore, as I've transitioned into entrepreneurship in the live concert business, my company has evolved. And so I have an opportunity to produce and create activations and live endeavors with independent artists and emerging talent and give them access to an industry that they probably typically wouldn't have access to so early on in their career. So through that access with artists and talent on stage, beyond the main stage, I'm able to activate young professionals and give them a pipeline opportunity, give them access to helping produce some of these live event endeavors, giving them access to just be in the space and connect with professionals who are producing at a high level. And it's an honor to be at the forefront of this endeavor.
Wow, you are so busy. Both of y'all are just so busy. Yes. What kind of challenges do you see yourselves actually overcoming? Because I know there's challenges, but what do you see yourself changing in those challenges? What issues do you think are dissipating as you're continually pressing forward and creating more channels for minority women and you? Because I know, I just want to know, is it do you see any differences or,
I would say
especially in corporate America, I'm just curious because a lot of people talk about change and how they've been involved in change, but then they still don't see change after 30, 50 years.
Yeah.
So I'm just curious, like there has to be some change that you've seen that, you know, you've been a part of that.
On a micro level, I've seen change in within my own specific community, people who I have direct access to. I'm able to ignite this passion and align on these purposes that I'm on a mission to carve out and create. I've seen, so building community is definitely an opportunity for change. Amplifying this mission and this work is an opportunity for change. Connecting with brands and sponsors and creatives and professionals who are moving the needle, or decision makers, or who share the same ethos that I do. They may not be in the live music industry, but they share the ethos of driving forward marginalized groups and diversity and inclusivity, and giving women or non-binary groups opportunities and access. We share in those ethos so we can continue to move that needle forward. On a macro level, it may not seem like a lot of change has occurred, but there are changes that are occurred, and I'm hopeful that they'll continue to occur. I would say when things are changed on a political and a policy level, and when it comes to advocacy for creatives and in the arts, I think that's when you see the real impact that this community can have. But the smaller communities and that on that micro level is still super important, because then we're able to connect on this level, right? So there's change all over, and I'm just super hopeful that we'll continue to move forward.
Thank you. Thank you for being a catalyst to that change, pressing forward constantly. Because I'm sure you've seen, like, you haven't seen many women of color that look like you, and now how does that look like? I'm just curious.
I would say post-pandemic, there's been a lot of performative behavior in corporate America in positioning people who look like me, but not giving them a real voice. So there may have been some representation that has been provided, but the real representation is coming through our voice and our person and our likeness and who we are, right? And there's still a little bit of fight for that. But I would say there has been some performative changes, at least putting us in position, and what we do while we're in those positions is solely up to us as a people.
Love that. How can people apply to your organization? What are ways that they can stand out and be connected to you?
Absolutely. Well, if you have a passion for exploring new pathways in the music industry, whether it's the live concert business, technology, education, and anywhere that those three align, you can come to litoutlive.com, which is our website. We also have presence on all social platforms, from Instagram, where we have keywords and resources and terminology, and sometimes mentorship access and application opportunities for people to apply to. So definitely reach out, and just as a catalyst to explore careers beyond the live music industry, I just want to be a resource to my people.
And who are your people?
Just teasing you. The human race.
Yeah, I'd like to get, you know,
my people as in the human race. But more specifically, my people as in those who have been overlooked, I want them to be seen. My people as in Black and brown communities, women of all backgrounds, non-binary even, LGBTQIA, just standing up for all parties.
All parties. Yes. Now let's party. I'm just teasing.
I really resonated with what you said, Candace, about, you know, there are some strides being made at the appearance of giving, you know, like a place, but structurally, you know, underneath it all, there's still a lot of work to be done. And part of that, I feel, is because, you know, at the student level, like, students are still not aware of the power that they do have. So like the students that I'm working with, you know, they're coming from diverse backgrounds, such it's a continuation school. So these are students that are almost out of the traditional school system. And then the fact that I'm able to like resonate with them at a level where they're now interested in going to school, or at least I think they are, but asking him to reach out and have a voice, because like a lot of, you know, a lot of it is that people don't know how to use their voices, or they're afraid to use their voice. And I guess systemically, we, you know, the transformation of utilizing the voice, like the panel that you were on speaking about hip hop culture, like, you know, to me growing up in the Inland Empire, you know, it was all hip hop culture growing up, but I got a nice diverse range of everything influencing me. And to hear other people's voices, and me, you know, being a young Hispanic, you know, from the IE, like there was a lot of restrictions placed on me. Breaking through all of that and really forcing the issue at like my guild level, it's still difficult to get into the guild. So how do we create pathways, but also how do we give students a voice to kind of like say, oh, I want to be in there. Lamo was speaking about how it's very difficult to get into the guild, and you know, we're not opening the door to everybody, and we need to have more panels. I'm working on a panel, and I mentioned it to you, the Eagle Con. You know, Eagle Con is.
Can you mention that? What
oh, sure. Cal State LA Eagle Con, March 17th is the Meet Your Professionals Day. And I asked Candace to be involved if she's available. I don't want to
go on the spot. March 17th.
That's right.
March 17th. And all kinds of industry professionals are going to be there. And we're having round tables. We're having high level production designers. That's not really why I go there. I started out in construction. So I'm about the meat and potatoes of how things are built and how can I get in.
Yeah.
You know, to see lofty goals of like, oh, here's this person that does production design for all the Steven Spielberg movies. That's great. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. It's iconic, but it doesn't really relate to me.
And it's not everyone's story.
Right.
Not everyone's gonna be that. Right. But we all, how I like to look at the world is we all have our place. We all have our piece of the puzzle that we're contributing to this bigger thing, bigger piece of art.
You and music. Yeah.
Oh, I love her. Bigger piece of art. She's speaking my language. Okay.
You know, we all have our own paintbrush
and
colors to add to the bigger canvas. So I like that we don't all have to be the big Steven Spielberg designer, but we can aspire to other endeavors that are gonna carve out our own path within that, you know, just be inspired by that, right? So I definitely think that we should strive to be like others, but you know, carve out our own path in so many other ways.
Yeah, that's kind of why I moved my focus over to education, because like I can still get projects, you know, I'll pick up a show here and there and work on the show, but there's a lot of new artists coming in and they are having a hard time finding work, and also students don't even know how to approach this. So the fact that I get to influence like the direction of students and where they're kind of like percolating with ideas, and I'm like, you guys change the future, because it's changing so fast with all of the AI and stuff like that, which is kind of taking away a lot of jobs, but at the same time you're still going to need innovation.
That's what it is, innovation and creativity. And for me, you know, we as young people don't always grow with that confidence, right? We don't always, we're not always like, sometimes it's innate. For me, it has been developed. I would say even becoming an entrepreneur in my entrepreneurship, when I worked in corporate America, because my voice was silenced a lot, I put my head down and did the good work, right? Because I wanted to sustain not only economically, right? I had bills to pay, but I wanted to sustain my positioning. I wanted to continue to do the things that I loved. So I put my head down and did the work, and I didn't really share my voice. But now as an entrepreneur on the other side, I almost don't have a choice. In order to drive my mission forward, people want to hear from me. People want to see me. People want to know, who is this person behind this mission? So I have no choice. But I grew up in foster care. I grew up shy. I didn't grow up empowered. I didn't grow up trusted with much. So now, yeah.
How did you find that, having that trust within yourself, from knowing you came from foster care, I'm sure from different homes, how did you hone in like that trust and security within yourself and know who Candace is and be rooted in yourself? Because a lot of people living in Los Angeles feel so lost, right? They're like, there's so many things to do. What are people doing on social media? but you came from here to there. I'm just curious how you were able to hone your sense of security and how someone can cultivate that who don't know, like the youth.
It's not people driven, I'll tell you that. It's spiritual driven. It's knowing my position and power in this world that allows me to kind of step into it, even scared. It's knowing that I've failed and experienced setbacks, but I've also persevered and overcome. It's being inspired by my own resilience. It's having mentorships and guidance from so many different aspects and avenues, right? My mentors and my many board of directors in my life, right? They're not just mentors as me as a professional, but I'm a mom also. So I have mentors, moms who, and people who are in the church and people who are friends and colleagues and just people who I admire. I lean into them for mentorship, and they're all my mini board of executives over my entire life. And so it's just not me, right? And it's not only about people, but God puts people here to be that. So I've identified those different executives, executive board members of my life. And even if, like I said, they're stay-at-home moms and they're just momming good, they're doing a good job at being a mom. I'm inspired by that, and I could use that mentorship, you know what I mean, that guidance. So for me, it just wasn't being parented by one person or two people. It was being parented in many different aspects of the world.
Wow, that's a beautiful story.
Thank you.
I think there should be a film about your childhood.
Eventually there will be. There's so much more. There's so many layers. Eventually there will be.
Okay.
Yes.
We'll see a Candace film one day, everybody.
Yes, you will.
We're gonna close out real quick.
Okay.
So we can just reiterate for each of you what kind of feels that prospective mentees or apprentices can learn from you guys, and also how they can reach you.
Okay, great. So what kind of fields can your mentees apply to, and where can they reach you, and just briefly mention your company name? And
so again, I'm Candace Newman, CEO and founder of Live Out Live. You can find mentorship and guidance on our platforms throughout the internet. Liveoutlive.com is our website. We are on all social media platforms. We currently are running and have recently launched a new mentorship program within the live music industry. So if you're interested in career pathways in live music, which so many ways to get into that industry, so many skills are transferable to come into that industry. So don't look at yourself in a limiting way where you can't have a career in the live music industry. Follow us and lean into Live Out Live, and I'm happy to help you explore.
And once again, I'm Dionisio Tapoya. I am with the Art Directors Guild. You can find the Art Directors Guild at adg.org. I'm also with Creating Creators. They are creatingcreators.org, I believe. And then my company is Dionysus Creative, dionysuscreative.net. It's a little difficult to spell, but you can figure it out. And then, you know, we have the EagleCon, which is happening throughout the year, but the next event is on March 17th at Cal State Los Angeles. Career pathways that you can get with, you know, the whole ball of wax that I'm working with is everything within the Art Directors Guild, which is everything from graphic design, illustration, model making, digital previz. We're even looking at bringing in researchers, the film researchers, to our guild. Also art direction, production design, set design. Those are the basic skill sets, but there's many, many pathways to get in, like formal construction, themed entertainment construction, digital design, AR, VR, gaming, all that stuff. It all kind of ties together.
Absolutely. There's not just one door. There are plenty of windows in the house, right? So you just find your way in.
Yes.
By any means.
See, there's many opportunities, right?
That's right.
See, and you have these people to help you. So don't be afraid. Have the courage and be brave.
Thank you for having me.
Okay.
High five.
Yes.
Okay.
Thanks so much.
It was a pleasure meeting you. Do I? Yes. I'll give you another card. I remember.
Just over there.
Text or email or whatever.
I'm going to text any.
Hit me up about that mural.
I will.
Like to talk to you
yes,
some more
I'm
going to
email
plans.
You about the event on the 17th.
Yes, okay. Yes, I'd love to have you.
To talk to you too about, but we're going to talk soon.
Yeah,
okay. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. We're yeah. around. We're
whatever,
connected.
What you need help with, I'll be
totally
too.
Same.
Okay.
Yeah.
Same.
Of course.
It's a hard time.
I'm in North Hollywood.
I have an internship getting ready to go up in North Hollywood.
Okay.
Well,
oh, really? Oh, wait. Do you want to mention it really quickly? He needs to mention.
No, no,
okay.
It's fine.
Okay.
Do it. So we got.
You have so many things.
You have this chance.
Okay.
We got. You need a break.
Oh. Yeah. I'll have a water break.
Okay.
Yes,
I'm looking to speak about under the next scene. Yeah, I don't know. Is that thing causing their
it was. But then when it took off, it just felt louder. You know, I mean, the dead can tell for me and win, right?
Yeah.
So I just took it off and I was like, you're easier.
Yeah, no, not a script.
I took it off.
I'll do
the quote of that.
That's one part of this. It's the next part of it. And then here's the it's not you. I think the power bank could work. So like, my hand. Isn't that something?
Not really. Thank you.
So, you know, these two guys here are going to talk more about.
It wasn't me.
We're going to talk more about our program. The program of taking young people 16 to 16 and be able to get them through mentorship. Money that will allow them. Earn real living wage so that they keep pace with all this economy. So I have three people, including JP here, who are not there with them. So, but the goal is really just to be conversational. You've done a great job about now the program. Give us the idea of the program, and that's what we're trying to cut into our first word today.
Okay, so talk more about the program.
Tell us about the program. And he's going to talk more about the state funded, state registered apprenticeship program.
State registered.
Department of Labor, we have an apprenticeship program. And in 2 weeks, we'll have our approval of the state of California, which is going to give us a lot more infrastructure support and all the things that we haven't discovered as people today because we discovered them.
Okay.
We're trying to discover and make a match for everything that we can grab, you know, to attach to their individual needs.
Okay.
I'm older.
I'm 36.
No way.
Yeah.
Okay. I thought she was much younger.
Possible.
What high school did you go to?
Hamilton. It's like Culver City.
And how old am I?
I don't know. I'm older than all y'all. I'm like 30.
That's not a, you're older than me?
Yeah. No, I'm older than you.
You're older than me?
Yeah.
You're 36 and I'm 30?
Interesting.
Right.
Don't tell anybody.
You are older than me, probably just by a year.
Damn.
Or only several months. I'll be 36 in April.
Okay, then I'm like 6 months.
Get you this.
You know, maybe 5 months.
I'll respect my old.
If I did that, people would think I would have the Napoleon syndrome. Oh, who's the short girl?
No, it's good. You have to, especially in this case. You gotta, you gotta put your story out there, make sure people understand.
Thank you.
Who you are and do those kind of things. So.
Thank you very much. Hi, Rena. And I met you already.
Yes, you did.
Same.
That's right. It's such a pleasure.
It's been a pleasure.
All right. Sorry about that, guys. Let's start rolling.
Okay, so do you know what to talk about?
I'll follow your lead.
All right, so go ahead again. Just introduce yourself and each person, and then just basically just ask about his. Try to stay in line of more mentorship.
Right? Okay.
So, like, why are they here? What are they trying to network? Are they trying to scout for?
Switch out right now. The first gentleman here is now the new surf director for LEDC, Charles. Michael Johnson, okay, Marina, Mr. Terrence, and sir, and Pete. So please, okay. So Charles, and we're just going to ask you some just conversational things about who we are and what you're looking at. Okay.
Just introduce yourselves and where you're from, why you're here.
Marina
Charles.
Hi, Charles.
Terrence Coles.
Terrence Coles.
Coles. C-O-L-E-S.
Oh, Coles. Okay.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
And then once you've introduced yourself, you can kind of talk about how you guys are planning or what you're doing to try to get you more involved in the team. If you have more different programs, apprentices, or you can get more engaged.
Okay, great. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Microsoft Office. My name is Rena Tolentino. I'm an artist, curator, brand relationship manager, and I'm here today with some talented people, and they're going to share with us about their mentorship program, their apprenticeship program. So please, please, please tell us why you're here today and what programs you have going on, what projects you have, and what you're looking for. Are you looking for mentors, mentees? Tell us everything. Please introduce yourself.
Sure, by the way. Yeah. My name is Charles Johnson. I'm program director for Community Economic Resilience Fund program at LEEDC. And essentially what we do is we're regional convener. We get a lot of community-based organizations, bringing them together and talk about different pain points and what's going on in their communities. And the state has released some monies to help alleviate some of those problems. So right now that's part of what I'm doing.
So you say the state is going to release some funds. When will that be?
Actually, the Los Angeles region, every region in California has already been awarded $5 million.
Okay.
We've been awarded. We haven't got it yet, but we've been awarded the money. It's on its way. And that's just going to be to help do a lot of different activities in order to bring people together, talk about different projects that they may have, collaborate, use each other as resources to create different pilot projects and have the state fund that, because in 2 years, there's going to be a bigger pot of money. It's going to be sectioned off and given to all the different regions throughout California, where those pilot projects will be used to create jobs for people in underserved communities, help launch businesses, generally with people from underserved communities, all to kind of help mitigate the carbon footprint as well. So.
Okay, where do they apply?
surf at LAEDC.org. You can just send an email there and one of the team members will take care of it from there.
Should they attach a cover letter, their resume, what they're looking for to do?
Well, as long as they're a business organization or, some type of activist, you can be a single person, that's really, has a vision of how you want to see LA. Something, again, the pain point in your community that you want fixed, sign up to it, and then, work with all the others who have signed up. come up with a plan and send it off to the state and see what they say.
Okay, so what does that process look like? Months? Like, how does it normally?
Well, we do know this is government, so we know we're talking about years, nothing months. Okay. But no, the planning process is probably between 18 and 24 months.
Okay.
And you want to make sure it's right, you know. So this is all part of that $5 million that's coming in is to help pay for like researchers, because once that plan goes out, it has to be informative, it has to be accurate. And you don't want to go in and saying, well, hey, let's make a movie with Dwayne The Rock Johnson, you know, we only have $10,000. That's not believable. It's not easy.
Probably his daily rate.
That's hourly rate, probably.
Hourly rate.
So, but yeah, so the money's going to be used for to make sure that that plan is professional.
Okay, cool. So that's already like happening right now. You're just waiting for the funds to just come in.
Well, kudos to LAEDC. They actually, even though the funds have not come in, LAEDC hired me, paying me out of their pocket until that fund comes in.
Wow, I got to get your job.
Careful what you wish for.
Okay, maybe I don't. Okay, great. Great. So I'd like to know more about you. Can you please introduce yourself and tell us what program you're a part of, your mentorship, apprenticeship program? I know something is going on in 2 weeks, but a little birdie told me, but I'm not sure. But please elaborate and share that.
So I'm Terrence Coles. I've been working with the Dakar Foundation for the Performing Arts for about 15 years. So definitely how this all came about. So some of the first two apprentices that we pulled together and brought to the table here are Timon and also JP, who's shooting right now. So really, you know, I've been part of the process in trying to bring some of the talent through a digital video editing program to the state and other organizations and provide people with opportunities. So we're, you know, here applying for some of the funds on behalf of some of the students that we have that we've been working with. So that's really been our interest in, and you know, we started, I met Kevin probably 15, 20 years ago. We've been to Compton Unified School District. We've been at LA Mission College. I've taught courses on immersive media exploration and careers. So I'll be doing a workshop in St. Louis at Webster University about career exploration in the field of AI, AR, VR, immersive media. So really taking the technology and trying to use that and you know, melding that with the traditional production, right? So I think that's what's missing. I mean, here there's pathways. You hear about all the futuristic kind of things, but you don't necessarily understand that there's a foundational backbone. So that's why we started with digital video editors, so that they could come here, produce programs like this, and then move to the next level. Notice we're on a green screen. So there's going to be some kind of virtual set behind the green screen, right? So there's jobs and opportunity from the shooting all the way to what turns out to be the final product. And that prepares you for things like The Mandalorian, you know, and that's coming out tomorrow and those kind of things. So really trying to bridge those gaps that exist with talent and really, you know, mentorship. Really, my goal would be to see other folks who maybe haven't had those opportunities, who come from Black and Brown communities, underserved communities, have those kind of opportunities here in the industry. And I think that's why we're here at Microsoft today. So why I came today was just to open some doors and find ways that people can you know, find those opportunities.
That's great. And thank you. We see what you've been working on. Like, everyone's here. Like, that's so great to see the faces that you've actually been talking about working this event. So